So I've been learning this open source game engine called Godot, and it's been a lot of fun. I actually made that intro you just saw with Godot, and I think it turned out quite well. But that's not what this video is about. This video is about taking a mesh from inside Godot and 3D printing or CNC machining it. Why would you want to do this? Well, I've had a lot of fun learning how to generate terrain in Godot using the surface tool, and I thought it would be cool if I turned it into a real-life object. Unfortunately, Godot doesn't make this easy. Although that's obviously not its primary focus, it is a game engine after all. But I thought STL files are pretty simple, and making a plugin would be another interesting learning opportunity, so that's what I did. First, I'll show you how to use it, and then I'll show you how it works. So first, here's my terrain project. I have a terrain here generated. I have a CSG node here with a generated mesh, and then I also have some cylinder. And now we'll go to my website and download the zip file. There's a link in the description. When we unzip it, we can find the Save As STL folder in the Add-ons folder. To use the plugin, we simply put that folder in our own project's add-on folder. Then we can go to Project, Project Settings, and the Plugins tab. Make sure Save As STL shows up and that you set the status to active. Now we can simply select the node which has a mesh and then go to Project, Tools, Save Selected Nodes Mesh As STL. Oops, I got an error. As you can see, I forgot to select the node. Select the node and then you can go. A file dialog appears and you simply save the STL file where you like. Now we can open it in our favorite slicer or CAM software for 3D printing or CNC machining. Now let's have a look at the plugin code. So here you can see I have the Save As STL project, and basically this is just all for testing. The add-on itself is all located down here, and these are also actually just a test file. One important file with the plugin is the configuration file, but this file does not appear in the browser. We have to open it manually. I have it open here already, otherwise you can go over here, open, and check all files, and open the plugin. So this is important, you just have the name, the description, author, version, and the script file that is the actual add-on, or at least where the add-on starts. Here I get the selection from the editor. This is what allows me to find the selected node. This function is called when the add-on is started, and this line here adds the menu item, this one here that we can see here. This function creates a dialog that will eventually be used when saving the file and sets it up with some default values. This is the export function that actually gets called, you see, from the menu item when we click on it. And what we do here is that we get the selection, and when we check if it's empty. If we haven't selected anything, then we print an error. Otherwise, we get the selection, and then we check if it's a mesh instance or a CSG shape, because these are the only shapes that have meshes, or at least that I know of and that are supported by this plugin. If the dialog does not already exist, then we add it into the scene. This part helps with the naming of the file, as well as remembering the path. And this is the actual STL function. So what we want in the end is to have an array mesh. Depending on what kind of node we've selected, there are different ways to acquire this array mesh. So if it's a CSG shape or any other, you know, CSG thing, then we first have to call this function update shape to make sure that it actually has the proper shape, and then we can acquire the meshes. We can check if it's an empty shape, if there's nothing in it, and then we print an error. Otherwise, this entry here is going to hold the mesh. This is not an actual list, it's just two items. I think the first one is a transform or something, but the second one is the actual mesh. On the other hand, if it's a mesh instance, then what we have to do is figure out if the mesh used is a primitive mesh or an array mesh. And if it's an array mesh, then we already have our array mesh, that's what we want, so that's what we'll use. And otherwise we'll have to acquire the array of triangles from the primitive and then turn it into a proper array mesh. And if none of this works, we'll print an error. Here we start creating the file that we're actually going to save it to. It has to start with solid and a name. And then we're going to go through all of the surface counts, and generally speaking there's only going to be one, but there could be more, but then we'll check if the surface type is primitive triangles, because that's the most commonly used type, and that's the only one I have supported. And so we acquire that array here, and then we have to check if it's index mode, that is if the vertices are being reused, or if it's, you know, normal mode where every vertice is only used once. And so there's a little bit more going on with the index, but that's just reusing the indexes according to the numbers. In normal mode, we just use them, you know, three at a time. This function here, turn, all it does is turn the mesh 90 degrees to make Z point up, because Godot has Y pointing up, but Z pointing up is more common for 3D printing and such. We use this function here to calculate the normals. It doesn't seem like it's actually necessary, because 3D printing programs seem to be able to figure it out anyway, but it's a good thing to do it right. And then finally we write each face using this function here. This is how a face looks in a STL file. And then when we're done, we end the solid, and then we close the file. Notice that I named the file with .part here at the end, and then once it's completely finished, I rename it. This is just a good practice to always do this. At the end here is just a bit of cleanup. Remove the menu item and remove the dialog if it exists.
Alright, thanks for your time. Please like and subscribe for more videos.